I call to order the August 3rd meeting of the West Sacramento City Council Redevelopment Agency and Financing Authority. We're going to begin tonight, as we do each week, with the Pledge of Allegiance. We'd like to invite our guests to join the council and staff in the pledge, which tonight will be led by Mr. Rodolfo Ortiz. The council did meet in closed session this evening to confer with our legal counsel regarding one matter of significant exposure to litigation. You're turning on your microphone for a reason.
Oh. Yes, we did meet on one matter related to exposure to litigation, but there is nothing to report out at this time.
And I just said that. Okay, thank you. All right, so we're going to proceed to our general administration agenda. Item 1A first, presentations by the public on matters not on the agenda but within the jurisdiction of the City Council. As is noted in our agenda, we're not able under state law to have a discussion or take action on items that are brought before the council under item 1A, but it does provide an important opportunity for a public forum and items that are in our jurisdiction. We do ask that anyone wishing to address the council on this or any of the other items on our agenda tonight to please fill out one of the yellow cards that's available at the door and turn it into the city clerk. In front of the clerk is a timer that we use to make sure that everyone has the opportunity to be heard. And to that end, we ask that all comments be limited to no more than 3 minutes. We also recognize that for some folks, speaking in public can involve some anxiety. And so we do ask that there not be any boos or catcalls or applause or other demonstrations that we maintain a civil discourse in the chambers. When we, for each of our items this evening, there's a posted sign as well that reinforces this. But we take the speaker request cards all the way up through the conclusion of the staff report. Once the council's questions and the public testimony have begun, we don't take any additional speaking request cards. And for item 1A, once the public comment has begun, we cease the cards as well. And so if you have an intention to speak tonight on one of the agenda items, please get the card in as soon as you can. Also in front of the clerk is a flip chart, and that chart indicates which agenda item we are currently considering. So with that, we have a couple of requests to speak under item 1A, and the first is by Debbie Groves.
How's that?
There we go. Okay. She knows her microphones.
I've been in this situation once or twice before. In any case, Mayor and members of the City Council, it's a pleasure for me to be here tonight before you to ask for support for bringing a financial planning day to the area. We've scheduled an event for October 8th of 2011 this year. It's from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. The event has been created through a partnership of four national nonprofit organizations. Those organizations include the U.S. Conference of Mayors, the Certified Financial Planners Board of Standards, the Financial Planning Association, and the Foundation for Financial Planning. My name is Debbie Gross, and I'm a certified financial planner, and I'm the co-chair for the steering committee of planning this event. My committee and I have been working with John Perry and Michelle Juarez of your fine city staff, and they've been very helpful with their assistance. And through their help, we've determined that the city of West Sacramento would be an ideal place to hold this event and a perfect partner, a perfect local partner. The event is designed to give residents and community members the opportunity to speak one-on-one with a professional financial planner, certified financial planners, to ask their financial questions at no cost. The advice is provided by CFP, certified financial planners. It's free. There will be no sale of products and no strings attached or follow-up. The types of advice or counseling that people may expect to receive during these one-on-one counselings are a wide range of financial planning topics, everything from how to make the most of your employee benefits, how to navigate a career change, as well as some of the more common financial planning questions we get about savings goals and preparing properly for retirement. The one-on-one sessions will be specific to the individuals who are seeking the advice. In addition to these one-on-one counseling sessions, we'll also be hosting a series of free classroom-style educational workshops presented by certified financial planners on a variety of topics, including such things as paying for and accumulating for college education and funding, retirement planning, strategies around debt management. The event is intended to be for the greater Sacramento area. However, we have a special focus of providing these services to the city of West Sacramento. Through John and Michelle's help, we've already been connected with the City of West Sacramento's Chamber of Commerce and the Economic Development Department. So with that, I see that my 3 minutes is about up, and I would just like to say if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer those, and we'd really like your support in this bringing this event.
Debbie, thank you. This is the Dollarize campaign is a joint campaign, as Debbie said, of the various organizations, and I've been involved in it at the national level at the U.S. Conference of Mayors, and I'm excited about the folks locally stepping up in the region to make this happen. It is it's extraordinarily important levels of financial literacy, not just here, but all across the country. We need to be paying a lot of attention to it now more than ever, as we have a lot of our local residents who are experiencing sort of financial interruptions and hardships and unanticipated events in their lives, and have to shift their financial strategies, or in their workplace, their pension and other retirement programs are shifting dramatically. It's really critical to provide this kind of a service, and so I want to underscore it is a joint partnership, and it depends a lot on the volunteerism of certified financial planners and who are members of the association. But it is not a sales proposition.
Absolutely
it is around
not.
Providing the sort of basic services and answer basic but important and personalized questions in a personalized manner that can be really useful to residents of our community and the broader region. So we're really glad to be partnering to make this happen. So thanks for being part of it.
Wonderful, thank you.
All right, Rodolfo Ortiz, on behalf of the Yolo County Children's Alliance.
I'm a Rodolfo Ortiz. I'm a community resource specialist for Yolo County Children's Alliance. We assist families to apply for health insurance. The reason me being here is because we're doing our yearly backpack giveaway, and we are in need of supplies. The backpacks are given to families with low income that can't afford backpack supplies for their kids. As of now, last year we only gave about 50 or less. This year, we have about 350. We are getting the backpacks. The only thing that we're not gonna be getting is the supplies. So I just wanna ask if anyone can help out. I gave you guys the paper with the supplies that could be needed. And you guys can take the donations to Alice Thorman Elementary. And if you guys have any questions.
Questions? You don't need to be nervous. I know you work with Katie, and she's a stormtrooper, but we're very nice here, so you can relax, Mr. Villegas.
Yeah, I just wanted to say a couple things. Thank you for coming out. I know this is a worthwhile cause. It's done all over the county, and I know Supervisor Matt Rexroad from Woodland started this, and he works very hard to try to collect the backpacks. And I know the Children's Alliance this year is taking on the lead in West Sacramento, and I know that the need is much higher than it has been in the past. And although we're collecting pretty good numbers of backpacks, you know, the backpacks only go so far. The supplies are what also are very expensive, and they can use everything from, you know, box of colored markers to glue sticks to pencils to all the things that you would imagine you would find in a fully filled backpack. So I think you guys are collecting them at Ellis Norman School. Is that Friday or is that any time?
We're still debating on that. It's probably going to be taking place next week, because tomorrow we're going to go shopping for the supplies that we're able to get with the funds. And then on Friday, we're going to go pick up the backpacks that we got.
Okay. All right.
So probably most likely next week, Monday.
Okay. So next week at Ellis Norman, they can drop them off. Great.
Yeah. Right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right, Debbie Reynolds.
Hi. I think you probably heard a couple of emails from me. I'm the crazy person that wanted the West Sacramento Veterans Day Parade, and the answer from the city was for me to take out their permits, and my first answer back was, are you crazy? I manage apartments. I can't throw a parade. But I went to our company and asked them, could they support the parade? It was really important. The apartments that I manage are over there on Evergreen, and it's an affordable housing complex for seniors and disabled that also has a veterans preference, which means that veterans jump to the top of the Section 8 waiting list. So we house a lot of veterans. So now we took out the permits for the parade. We have everything going and running. The reason why my company supported me was because there was nothing like this in West Sacramento or Sacramento for years. And about a week ago, I found out that all of a sudden Sacramento decides they're gonna do a parade too. But the thing about the Sacramento parade is that it's city sponsored, which being in West Sacramento, it's a little bit hard to compete with when people get wind of that parade, which ours is way more advertised because we started way back in February on this. But when they get wind of that parade and someone asks, do you want to march down Park Boulevard or the Capitol Mall, some people might back out of our parade and decide to do the Sacramento parade. So what I'm asking now is, we took out the permits. My company covered the insurance on the streets. We have the advertising out. We have some large groups coming out, like the UC Davis Aggies Banda. We have the Sacramento City College Dance and Cheer Teams. We have the Cal Auto Museum, the River Cats, and so all I'm asking now is support from the city to show that, you know, you're here for this event, maybe some confirmations on attendance. It's the latest parade in this region. Ours starts about an hour or so after all of the other parades end. So people, if you have other commitments, you could still make it to our parade. Assemblywoman Yamada has already confirmed her attendance, so if you can't make it to watch the parade, which I think it would be really important to the veterans of this community, and I'm not talking about just the veterans at the VFW Hall. I don't know if you know this or not, but a lot of members of the police force are veterans as well. So that's all I'm asking, is for you to come out and show your support, and maybe if someone would like to speak at the post-parade assembly, and if the city can just start to stand behind the parade.
Oh, yeah, you've got flyers. If you hand them to the city clerk, and she'll make sure that we get them, and also that we can put the information on the city's calendar and share it with some of the community partners as well, so that there's a broad, so folks in the community know what's going on and know about the great volunteerism that you've been leading in this effort, just out of your own personal spirit and passion to make it happen. I bet we will be able to make that happen. I would be surprised if that couldn't happen. So we can't talk about it here, but we will. The city clerk and we'll work with us to see how we can accomplish that. So, all right, those are all the items under 1A. So we're going to proceed to item 1B, council communications. Are there any reports or other communications this evening, Mr. Johannesson?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mayor. The West Sacramento Housing Development Corporation met on July 28th, and it really was just an update. All the units are proceeding normally. We've got our vacancy is manageable. We're going to be getting a one-sheet status from this point forward that we'll be able to share with council to give you all a little more information about the number of units that are out there and families who are being supported. And also the CHOTO application, which is a community-based housing development organization application by the HDC, has been submitted. And that will allow, if approved, that organization to access more federal HUD money, which will be very important to implement some of these projects.
Yeah, I guess.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just to report quickly, the Port Commission met earlier this evening and we approved a 49-year lease for approximately 16 acres for the West Coast Recycling Group to hopefully move forward with their project.
Ledesma.
Thank you. This past Monday, the 1st, was a meeting of the city school 2x2. I attended on behalf of the city, and board member Minke was the lone representative from the school board. During that meeting on Monday, we had an update on the Up for West Sac organization and their preschool program from Justine Jimenez, who had some very good information about the program. The enrollment is up. It's showing good progress. There's even signs, although there's not enough significant sample size to look at how the cohorts of the early preschools are doing now in the second and third grade, but some observational data shows that they are performing well. Like everyone else, there's some funding issues with that that puts them in a bit of a tenuous position, but it was good to get the information from her and for both the school board and ourselves. The second issue on the agenda during the meeting was on the facilities update and specifically the track. This is something that was brought up early in the year about making the track at River City High School available to the public. We were working, the city, our staff had worked with the board, the school district, to come up with some proposal to allow us to use the track on a limited basis, maybe as a pilot program, to see if we can manage through that. Unfortunately, the school district or school board wants to hold that off and wait for a larger discussion on our arrangements, current arrangements for city and school shared uses. I will say that board member Menke and the superintendent were very supportive of us, keep pushing the item, but for now I think we're going to table talk of the track opening. We've done our work and it's just a matter of trying to get through with the district and trying to find a way we can find a common understanding of how we can work together on projects like this. So we'll keep pushing as much as we can during the school 2x2. So those are two items. Thank you.
I just want to encourage our 2x2 representatives to keep pushing on it. I mean, I know we've had this issue up for a while, and I think it's unfortunate sometimes our partners think of the adults in the community as the city, when the adults in the community are also the parents and the taxpayers, the bond payers for all of these facilities. And so a request by citizens of the Washington Unified School District to be able to use the track or the facilities on a public basis isn't a request from the city asking the school district to do something for the city government. It's just we share the same constituents. I know the member, our representatives on the 2x2 are well aware of this, but it just really is you know, we need to keep pressing this issue. It's not a treaty negotiation between two governments. It's about how can we jointly work to fulfill a request by a large number of adult citizens of both of our governmental jurisdictions that paid for that track and for the entire facility to have a first-class high school facility that we both promised the residents of our community would be a public asset for everyone and that would be available for public use, that we fulfilled that promise together. And it's just that simple. So the notion that it might be, you know, that it needs to be part of some larger negotiations about who pays who for what and all of that, that's not the spirit in which that bond was approved, or that our two governments, you know, work together to serve the same adults and the same children. So I know you get that. I'm just adding my voice to whatever I know with the communication that our two representatives have been providing in the 2x2. Mayor Pro Tem Christoph.
I just had a question, and that was, you know, what seems to be the reluctance to use the track? I mean, I don't think there's really no money involved. I struggle with that. I mean, people want to walk around the track or they want to run. The track is a mile oval. So, I mean, I think that there's some real benefit as far as the community is concerned for people that are doing it because they can time themselves, they can they know exactly how far they've gone, and I just really can't see the reluctance in utilizing of a, this is a dirt, well, not really dirt, but I mean, it's just a track.
Right, and I share the frustration, and I think we made that clear. There are two concerns that I had. One is that our parks director, Bob, had done an admirable job putting together a plan that was ready to help. I think part of the concern was that it is an expensive track and the facilities. So just making sure somebody was out there, no one got hurt, no one damage was done, and who's. And I think we tried to manage that, and I understand that, but I think the overriding concern is we had a plan, and we were looking for, at least I was looking for, at least let's pilot it so that we could see how it goes, see how the staffing went, and I don't know what the reluctance is. I don't know what the overarching issues are, other than seemingly on inequities in the current arrangements across all facilities, and again, that's beyond sort of my immediate knowledge of the city district relationships and the previous MOUs that were penned on these joint use facilities. But again, I think in the room, I think we all understood that it's a challenge, and there's maybe the cultural shift we have to get to, a philosophical platform as. It was articulated that night that we need to understand that we are doing this for the benefit of our community. And I think we have to find a way to get to that common place and go from there. And I was encouraged by the superintendent, by board member Menke, that, we have to find a way to find that common ground. So it is discouraging in one breath because this was something that we were hoping to have maybe for the summer. People could test it out for the first time. I think we talked about it in January, Councilman Villegas and I were the first meeting, and it came actually from the district. But again, it's one of those things that we have to turn around and say, okay, now how can we use this and move forward and maybe look towards getting to a stronger, lower solution? Because I think both of you are right. We fully understand that this is a community benefit. That is, the facility is a great one. It's been used by the high school and has brought a lot of encouragement to the football team, to those who use it, and it would be great to have the community to be able to use it every once in a while to, like you said, to keep healthy and all things we're both interested in. So right. We'll keep at it.
These are school public assets held by the school district, and in other communities, schools simply open their facilities to public use. We rare among other cities, a generation ago, at the city said we would help to make that more, we would help with maintenance and services and what have you. But fundamentally, the provision of access, of public access to school facilities is the district's responsibility. When we raise the issue, it is because we're hearing from the same constituents. And so I want to gently object to the notion that it's our obligation to do it. And if we don't pay them to provide access to our joint public, then it won't happen. We've been helpful because we thought it was extra important, but it's not an issue of a city. The city is not requesting it for the city. The city's trying to be helpful and provide some additional resources and staffing in order to make it happen, as opposed to being something that's going to accrue to our bottom line. So. All right, Mayor Protem, Chris, have you any reports? All right, the council knows I serve on the Think Big executive committee that's working on the entertainment and sports center, most likely at the rail yard site for the arena and other entertainment activities. And that committee's work is proceeding. They've just finished releasing a summary result of the polling that's been done region-wide around a variety of financing options. And the short story from that work is that there's broad public support across the region, including here, for this facility and for some public involvement, but on very specific siloed, narrow financing mechanisms, not a tax measure per se, but things like locating cell towers on the facility or adding a couple of electronic billboards that generate lease revenue, a ticket surcharge at the facility itself, those sorts of things that are public instruments but that aren't taxes. And so that's been the focus of the committee's work on the financing side as well. And then the council's also aware they've launched the Think Big has launched the Citizen Architect Program, and there's 36 citizen architects in our city who are involved in design competitions and other sorts of work. They're not actual architects, but coming up with ideas and being partners in some of the design concepts for the facility and for the intermodal associated with it. And then a week and a half ago, I was at in Los Angeles for the summer leadership meeting for the U.S. Conference of Mayors. It's the first meeting that Mayor Vera Gosar from Los Angeles is our new president. So we convened for 3 days, and because we have a prominent president now, one of the big city mayors is the president, our whole meeting is a series of very important speakers. I can't report that we actually did that much business. We heard from a lot of cabinet secretaries and billionaires and celebrities, but I'm hoping that our next leadership meeting will be more focused on our own work. But it was interesting. I'll forward some of the presentations that we did get around some of the jobs issues. We did, the one area that we did focus a lot on was both the debt ceiling question and its impacts, but also some of the other stuff that's being held up at the federal level on transportation authorization, the FAA reauthorization, which is obviously a big deal, and several others. And did some strategy work around trying to influence the Congress, given the range of mayors that are at the table in that group. So. All right, item 1C is appointments to boards and commissions. We have none this evening, but it is my intention to make the Port Commission appointments at the next meeting if the council adopts the item tonight on the alternate appointments. Right, that brings us to the consent agenda, which is items 2 through 9. And we have amendments that are at the council's desk that are technical in nature to item 4, which is the park name item with respect to the Bridge District Water Storage Facility and Park Project. And we have some requests to speak on item 5. So item 5, we'll just pull from the consent agenda altogether and consider that separately. Are there any other items on consent that any member of the council wishes to pull, or any item for separate question or comment? All right, item 3 is consideration of resolution 11-62 authorizing submittal of a home application for the Bridge District Affordable Housing Project. Mr. Christoph.
Hi, Kathy. Yeah, my question is if we are not awarded the $4.9 million, how do we finance all the rest of what is necessary, especially the remaining balance of 2.6.
Well, there goes Kathy's big presentation. And
the financial type questions I can definitely handle. So on this project, just to clarify, we do have an existing commitment of redevelopment housing bonds.
Right.
That makes up the majority of the funding. What this money would do if we were awarded would be to bring down that housing bond amount, and that would free up that money for the Delta Lane project. So we're...
So who pays back the bridge loan?
The bridge loan for the home funds, right, would be to Bridge Housing. So
does Bridge Housing pay that back?
Eventually, yes. They would pay it back in the 55-year term.
Right.
But the money that it would free up would carry to the next project, which would be Delta Lane.
So really this project is fully funded and is funded by housing set-aside bonds.
That's correct, actually, yeah. Housing set-aside bonds and a couple of other sources. But in keeping with the practice that we go about with all of our affordable projects, we try to leverage as much outside money as possible before we put in our local funds and make those stretch as far as possible.
Okay, so what happens if the agency gets dissolved?
So in that case, the bridge housing commitment was made prior to mm-hmm. any legislation being adopted. The dual track would be, number one, if the agency isn't dissolved, it would be a standing loan agreement that would be honored. If it was dissolved, it would fall into the category in the legislation of an existing obligation because it has a loan agreement that's already been made. The source of the actual funding is housing bonds, so there's some security in terms of those being encumbered funds and related to debt or as opposed to regular housing set aside. So we're fairly secure in the realm of possibilities with that money staying in the project even if the agency is dissolved.
Okay, thank you.
Any further questions on that item? I also was at one of the block parties last night for the National Night Out Against Crime, and there was a Housing and Community Development Department staffer who was at one of them, who will remain nameless, who was glowing about, she said, the city of West Sacramento has a tremendous reputation in HCD. We love making grants there because the grants are solid, they're for good projects, they advance all of our criteria, and you guys get them done, you do what you say you're going to do, and it was completely unsolicited feedback, but a real testament to the work of the city staff team. So, all right, those were the only questions we had on consent. So is there a motion on the consent agenda minus item 5? It's been moved by Mr. Villegas and seconded by Mr. Johannesson. Seeing no further discussion, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, that motion carries. Item 5 is consideration of award of contract for the Bridge District Water Storage Facility and Park Project. So we do have a couple of requests to speak, but it would probably be appropriate to have a brief staff presentation on the item first.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. The item before you tonight is consideration of award of a contract for the Bridge District Water Storage Facility and Park Project. The Public Works Department opened bids for this project on July 21st. After review of the bids with Council Legal, with the City Legal team, staff has determined that the lowest responsible bidder was Canyon Springs Enterprises, and staff is recommending to award the contract tonight to Canyon Springs Enterprises. And that concludes my presentation.
All right, are there questions for staff at this time? All right, thank you, Mr. Bissett. We have two requests to speak on this item. The first is by Sean Thompson and Kevin Coops on behalf of Auburn Contractors.
Members, district staff. My name is Sean Thompson. I'm an attorney for Auburn Constructors. Auburn Constructors was the low bidder, the second low bidder on the Bridge District Water Facility project. First of all, I want to thank you for considering Auburn's concerns. We've sent in a couple letters on our bid protest. Just for background, Auburn's an experienced Sacramento contractor. They have a stellar reputation. Auburn has successfully completed a number of projects for the city of West Sacramento, including the 2001 wastewater treatment plant improvements, the Carlin tank and pump station in 2002, the construction of the fluoride storage and feed facility for the Bright Bend water treatment plant in 2008, and Auburn also successfully installed the generator and related electrical and concrete improvements at the Bright Bend water treatment plant in 2009. Auburn also responded to two emergency situations for the city. First, there was a chlorine glass system repair done at the now decommissioned water treatment plant, and Auburn repaired a ruptured wastewater force main along I-80. As I mentioned, Auburn is the second low bidder on this project. The low bid by Canyon Springs, as we detailed in our written communications to city staff, have four separate issues of non-responsiveness. I won't go through each of those, but I will list those. First, the bid by Canyon Springs failed to acknowledge two additional addenda that were issued to the contract documents describing changes to the work. Secondly, it appears that Canyon Springs failed to timely submit evidence of its qualifications to perform the work. Third, the bid security provided by Canyon Springs reflected the wrong date of the bid. And finally, Canyon Springs did not timely submit their bid documents to escrow as required by the contract documents. Because of the time limitations and the fact that we've briefed these in writing to council and district staff, I won't go through each of those. I will emphasize one, and that is an issue that we just discovered yesterday. And I want to thank district staff for providing us a large amount of documentation at the last minute. And the documentation consisted of communications regarding evaluation of the bids. And that revealed that Canyon Springs had not timely submitted evidence of their qualifications. Specifically, the bid documents required that the bidders describe project experience that met the type of construction work that was being performed here. Canyon Springs did not submit that until a week after the bid. And in fact, there's a communication along with the agenda materials that from the district's outside, the city's outside engineer that describes this failure. And it just simply says, RSH Construction Services, which is a DBA for Canyon Springs, has not submitted sufficient documentation to verify that they meet the qualification requirements specified, but that both Auburn Constructors and Gateway Pacific, the third low bidder, appear to meet the qualification requirements. If I could just indulge the council for just a few more seconds. I'll wrap up.
I need you, yeah. Okay. It's a rigid, unenforced rule, so.
I hear you. I would just, when you consider Canyon Springs' position on this, it amounts to, these are just minor details with the bid. Don't sweat the details. I would just submit to you that this is a $6.5 million water storage facility. The details matter. They're complex, electrical, computerized, and mechanical connections. If the city awards to Canyon Springs, could face a challenge. It could risk having the project stop midway, then award to another contractor, then having to still pay Canyon Springs for the work. If the city awards to Auburn, they get a contractor they know will do a good job, they'll get a good project, there will be no viable challenge for Canyon Springs because the bid is non-responsive and the city is under no obligation to waive that. So we would just respectfully ask that you make the prudent choice and award
actually
to Auburn.
All right, thanks.
Thank you.
All right, and then Gene Cheever on behalf of Canyon Springs Enterprises.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the City Council. Thank you for listening to me tonight. I'm here on behalf of Canyon Spring Enterprises. Mr. Robert Hamilton is here in the audience tonight. Canyon Spring Enterprises is the premier contractor in this area in the West, and they will do a very fine job for the City of West Sacramento. And actually, the bid by Canyon Spring Enterprises is $145,000 less than the bid by Auburn. And so it will be delivered, a quality project will be delivered to the City of West Sacramento at substantially less price. The issues that are raised by Auburn's council in their letters to the City of West Sacramento have been addressed with letters that Canyon Springs has written back. Those issues about the alleged non-responsiveness are simply without merit. The issues concerning the addenda are addressed in those letters. In fact, Canyon Springs acknowledged those addenda prior to bid opening. Auburn does not even make an argument that there was any advantage gained by Canyon Spring Enterprises regardless of that. Secondly, the timeliness of the bid escrow documents is not even an issue of bid responsiveness. The city had the option of taking in additional documents or any documents even after the 48 hours, which Canyon Spring Enterprises actually submitted those bid escrow documents in a timely manner because of the weekend closing. And so there is no issue about non-responsiveness for Canyon Spring Enterprises in this instance. And Council for Auburn just raised one issue that was not addressed in the letters, which is the failure to provide information with respect to its responsibility. But what Canyon Spring Enterprises actually did here was upon request by the city staff to provide further information, which is certainly allowed in these circumstances. Canyon Springs actually provided further information with respect to that, which is not really an issue at all. And so What you have here is the premier contractor in the state of, in the West, in the state of California, ready, willing, and able. It was the low, responsive bidder here to provide this project to the city of West Sacramento at $145,000 less than Auburn is willing to provide it. And the city of West Sacramento should go ahead and award as provided in its notice of intent and as recommended by its staff. Thank you.
Right, thank you. Those are all the requests you have to speak on item five, so we'll turn it to the council for the, well, actually, let me first ask Mr. Bissett if you have any further information or responses based on the testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just the fact that staff has carefully evaluated the items in Auburn's protest and the response supplied by Canyon, and staff believes, after consulting with the city council, that Canyon has successfully addressed each and every one of those items, and staff continues to recommend that the contract be awarded to Canyon Springs.
Let me just clarify, you mean the city attorney?
City attorney, okay. Yes.
The council to the city.
Sorry.
Thanks.
Yes.
All right, any questions for Mr. Bissett or the city attorney? All right, thank you. Then we'll return to the council for discussion or action.
I guess I can start out. Yeah, I'll start out. I think that Canyon's failure to acknowledge Addenda 2 and 3 and also the Canyon's failure to submit bid docs 48 hours after of the opening bid and then the wrong date. I mean, I think the wrong date really is sort of a red herring. It's closed. I think the bids were sealed, or the information was sealed in for the bonds, and I really don't think that would preclude Canyon from receiving this bid. And I do think that even on with one with the addenda and two with the failure to submit escrow bid documents within 48 hours. To me, they seem pretty minor. They don't seem like there are a lot of errors and miscalculations and things that cause the bid process to really get out of whack. And eventually require a lot of change orders and all the other things that we've had some instances in the past. These really don't seem to pass that test as far as I am concerned. So I would be, I'm willing to move forward with Canyon and accept their bid. I will listen to the comments of my fellow council members, but I'm willing to go along with staff's recommendation.
Mr. Villegas.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I would concur without repeating all of what he said. I think Bill hit it on the head, and I think it's certainly a responsive bid, and I don't think there's any unfair advantage provided given what we've seen and certainly what's for us this evening. So I would concur with supporting staff's recommendation.
Further comments? I would just, the protest, I think, noted that the details do matter, and they do, they absolutely do. And I think and the reason why we pay excruciating attention to the details on these bids is that we're talking about millions of dollars, and we want to make sure that as competitive bids come in, that that they're fair to one another, the process is fair, but we also want to make sure that if we award a bid to the lowest bidder, as we're required to do by law, and which makes sense for us, that we're going to get the project that is promised at that price delivered in an equality way. So that we do pay attention to the details, and we've considered bid protests many times here at the council on a variety of projects over time. And sometimes we have decided in favor of the protest because of those issues.
But that doesn't mean that every detail is the same, right? I mean, the reason, the intent of the public contract code provisions that govern all of this, that the legislature has passed on behalf of the people, is to assure fairness, to assure the maximum level of competition, and to assure that there's no fraud or corruption or favoritism in the contracting process. It's for those purposes, not simply for the purpose of having folks, make sure that people do stuff for the sake of doing it in terms of the details. And so as we pay attention to the details that really matter, that's the assessment that we're having to make. And I think the comments of my colleagues are very appropriate. The issues that have been raised don't have any effect on the material issues within the bids or the contract. They have been reviewed very carefully by our own staff. So it's not simply a matter of us looking at these and not paying attention to whether or not they are directly related to performance on the contract, as well as the maintaining the fairness of the overall bid process. And I think the documents and the reviews show that in this case, Canyon Springs Enterprises would be fully bound to the bid that was made. And so all of the key points that we would pay attention to with respect to evaluating the bids in this context are satisfied in this case. And so we simply can't reject a low bid and tell the people of our community, and also the people of the state of California are helping to, through grants, provide support for this project, that we are willing to pay $135,000 more because of an immaterial typographical area on a date, on a document. We need to know, for us to be able to look taxpayers in the eye and say we rejected a bid because, knowing that it will cost an extra $135,000, that we have a reasonable belief that that's a problem. And in this case, I think we can be fully assured that it is not. And so, for that reason, I think it is appropriate for us to adopt the staff recommendation and award the low bid. So I'd support what my colleagues have said, and I would ask if there's a motion on the matter.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I do concur with all the observations and the statements made. And with that, we'll make the motion to award the construction contract to the lowest responsible bidder, Canyon Springs Enterprises, in the amount of $6,414,252. Authorize expenses for construction management staff, oversight, and engineering support services. Appropriate an additional $1.2 million of CFD 27 funds for project construction, and grant the city manager or his designee authority to issue contract change orders up to 6% of the value of the contract. And so on.
It's been moved by Mr. Ledesma and seconded by Mr. Johannesson. Seeing no further discussion, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, that motion carries. That brings us to item 10, which is consideration and adoption of urgency ordinance 11-9, determining that the city will comply with the voluntary alternative redevelopment program pursuant to Part 1.9 of Division 24 of the California Health and Safety Code in order to permit the continued existence and operation of the redevelopment agency of the city of West Sacramento. Ms. Hamilton.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and members of the City Council. This item is essentially identical to the second reading that you just conducted on item number 6.
Literally. I got a lot of questions about this one. That was easy.
This, however, is proposed as an urgency ordinance, so it does include the necessary findings for public health and safety. A public hearing is not required for this item. It does require a 4/5 vote, however, to become effective immediately. This is essentially a belt and suspenders approach to AB 27, and it's being done to preserve all the options for the agency board and the council should you choose to need to do something within the next 30 days.
All right, are there questions for staff? All right, thank you. All right, this is for discussion.
I find it hard to believe if we did one on consent, we would make some changes on the other.
So is that Mayor Pro Tem Christoph has moved? Is there a second?
I will move the item.
Second. All right, second by Mr. Ledesma. Seeing no further discussion, all those in favor? Oh, it requires 4/5 vote. Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Councilmember Ledesma?
Yes.
Councilmember Johannesson?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Christoph?
Yes.
Councilmember Villegas?
Yes.
Mayor Cabaldon?
Yes.
Thank you.
That motion carries 5-0.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, we will not be having a meeting next week, and I just want to remind everybody that the farmer's market is still going on across the street on Thursdays from 4:30 on.
There's a new vendor. They have corn on the cob.
Oh.
They do. I bought a bunch of it last week. Yeah. I think and I've been eating it all week long. It's been it's from Dave's.
Yeah.
Okay. Any questions on the calendar? City manager report? At the Southport Parkway?
Well, I could, for the benefit of Mr. Kristoff, the...
I know I've had at least a handful of inquiries about it, so for folks in the public who may be watching this meeting might want the update as well.
Yes, there's a substantial fill operation going on in Southport Parkway. It commenced over the weekend and continued. We ceased the operation on Tuesday because there were some problems with traffic and dirt on the road. We've revised the traffic and circulation program and also the program to clean the streets. And so there's actually street sweepers out there on a constant basis. And we think that the hall is well on its way to being a success. This is not a precursor to any specific project. That's the question that we've gotten a number of times. What are we doing out there? What's going to be the project? There is no project at this stage other than to raise the level of that site a few feet. It'll improve and it'll enhance the developability of that project because it'll raise it out of a flood area. But it does not itself relate to any specific project, except that it is providing a mechanism to cost effectively remove material from the levees that are underway, the construction's underway, and save our money in those projects. There are actually two levee projects, and we'll be saving money on those two levee projects because we have a convenient location to put the fill, and it'll be providing about $500,000 benefit to the port in providing an increase in the height of that site. So that's what's going on. It'll probably continue for about a week. There'll be a suspension, then it'll start up again in a few weeks later as we remove more levee area up in the rivers, EIP. So I think that pretty much explains what's going on. It was a little bit of a surprise in the timing because we had arranged the permits, but we had no notion that they would move so quickly in degrading the levees because they hadn't intended to go that fast, but they saw a window of opportunity. They were able to arrange the trucks and they started going very fast.
All right, questions for the city manager? I don't have a question, but many of us or all of us attended at least one either in person or in spirit the National Night Out events last night. It was a big success, and the police department and as the lead organizer with all the neighborhood captains and all the other city departments that participated. It was a great success, and it's always a wonderful event to help neighbors connect with each other and to get exposed to some of the city services and just for us to connect together. So it was kudos to the departments and the city staff who are stretched thin on so many different ways, but definitely stepped up, and it was very much appreciated in all the neighborhoods. It's the highlight of the evening when the a second to when the city council members come by.
If you arrive on the fire truck, then that's really
if I arrive in the SWAT truck and Mr. Ledesma arrives in the fire truck and Mr. Johannesson in the Marine Corps vehicle and Mayor Pro Tem inside McGruff the crime dog suit. It is the high point of the evening. It really makes it. And so, and I know you've got your department head meetings tomorrow maybe, but please let them know that council appreciates and the community appreciates that all the department's work. Right, city attorney report.
I have nothing to report tonight.
All right, staff direction from members of the council. And we have no future agenda item requests. So is there a motion to adjourn?
Move to adjourn.
It's been moved by Mayor Pro Tem Kristoff and seconded by Mr. Villegas. All those in favor, please say aye. Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, motion carries. Meeting is adjourned.
How's it going?
Good.